Masters Oakland, live from Oracle Arena, where we are about to set up for game two between the Flash Wolves and the Unicorns of Love in this grand final. And the Flash Wolves, they dealt the first blow and took home game number one. Going into game two, we're going to jump straight into picks and bans with the Flash Wolves this time around on the blue side and see what they go with. They must have a lot of choices, of course. They had that Vel'Koz pocket pip coming out in game one that didn't do that much, but it has planted the seed of doubt probably in the mind of the Unicorns of Love as they decide to ban out Gangplank as a first ban coming out of the Flash Wolves.
I sure hope that Vel'Koz did not plant any seeds because I was not very impressed by that. But Jace, interestingly enough, was left up the previous game and was not picked up. So there's a lot of picks that went through that last game that can affect the outcome of this one tremendously.
Frostgrain, you had mentioned before that you did not particularly want to see the Gangplank from either side. Why do you think the ban is coming in here?
It could be that they want to prioritize having that Poppy there. Again, that's the thing that Gangplank really punishes in the 1v1 just because she is a melee champion. When she goes to clear those barrels, he's just going to punch her right in the face.
Absolutely. I think you're right on the money here. Gangplank and Kennen. Could it be more obvious that they want the Poppy?
They want the Poppy and absolutely get the edge over the Visichachi in that lane from MD again.
Yeah, but that means if they show their hand and if Unicorns of Love either decide to deny it or even possibly ban it, it makes Olaf such a more powerful pick simply because then you don't have that disengage available. It's kind of one of the soft answers to it.
Okay, no more.
And a Poppy ban.
Well, they're just saying screw it, so they're just going to throw everything out the window.
All right, so why?
Jace is up, so Jace is the only pick. I'm assuming that they want to say, hey, we are definitely going to pick Jace even though we didn't pick it last time. Although it would not make a whole lot of sense because MD, not really the guy that plays a whole lot of Jace.
Oh, this is shaping up to be a very interesting pick and ban and a very interesting strategy when the Unicorns of Love, of course, have to ban that Syndra out and also choose to ban out Karma.
Yeah, and reminder that the Gnar is also available. So while Jace is kind of the big priority, as well as the Ryze from the mid lane still left open, there are still options in terms of the top lane.
The puzzles are coming together here for the Flash Wolves.
Tahm Kench getting banned away, and now the Ryze is going to be the first pick for Flash Wolves. It's obviously going to be a mid-rise. We're not going to see that one in the top lane. So Maple going to go for that one. But this is an odd shift in priority for them because the Nidalee is again available for Karsa.
But I think that the Tahm Kench is just like they want Ashe, right? The previous game you were mentioning how important the Ashe was for the Flash Wolves. Right now they're saying, all right, you want whatever you want. We are going to make sure that when we get the Ashe, that the Tahm Kench is not involved. That way we can have that Bard as well if we choose to have that lane. Although, screw it, out the window. Jinn, who knows what they get?
I was just about to say, because the issue is the last time they also decided to ban the Jhin and pick away the Ashe. And again, both of those champions are pretty much interchangeable in terms of how they start fights with their ultimate. So don't prioritize the Ashe, but
with everything open in the jungle pool, the first Rek'Sai of the tournament, what is going on?
It's got to be a comfort pick. I mean, the thing with Rek'Sai is that she's still very good at finding lanes to camp and really influence them heavily.
Calm down.
By going, let's not get too excited about the hovers anymore. I think that we're not in Stanford versus Berkeley anymore, so we can expect the Olaf to be the correct pick.
Yes.
I think it's either going to be that Olaf or that Nidalee. We did see him hover back over that one, so it still is innately possible that we see that locked in for Karsa. Had a very good game on it. Just last game, played it again in game one versus Longju. So I think that he could go back to that one. I'm interested that the Jhin was the pickup here because the Ashe is still available and there's not a Tahm Kench. So if you see the curtain call go up, you send out the Enchanted Crystal Line Arrow and suddenly there's no more curtain call.
It's not just there, it's also the fact that Ashe works really well as kind of a counter to Jhin, just because if she does tap him with that arrow, it's going to completely deny his ultimate. But also the fact that you have the opportunity to take the Olaf. Olaf is known as a great pick into the likes of Jhin and Ashe because they are so immobile, he could just rush to that back line. So that's kind of two picks where Unicorns of Love had the opportunity to take something away or deny it from Flash Wolves and gave it away instead for comfort picks. Again, Move is known as kind of a control-oriented jungler, not necessarily a carry-oriented jungler.
So I think that with that control of the Rek'Sai, it becomes very obvious of what their game plan is. Rek'Sai with Bard is even more deadly than Olaf Bard because that means that they can go even over more walls to get behind your opponents. And when you have that in combination with the Cassiopeia, we actually did get to see Exile against Cassiopeia in their match against INTZ versus Tarkus, which he completely bodied. And if he is able to replicate a similar performance, but this time with the Rek'Sai, hopefully he gets blue buff, hopefully we see some ganks from behind him to the Ryze, and this could be a very action-packed game.
It also offers a lot more safety for that Jhin in the backline. The fact that Cassie will be sitting next to him, the Olaf can still run through and get down there, but there's that many more members to try to burn him down.
And now we are going to see the top lane pick coming out as well. And of course, they've pinched the top lane pool themselves, so they probably have something in mind, as well as the support pick still needed to come out from the side of the Flash Wolves. And it does seem to be Echo and Zyra to round up that composition.
I mean, Echo, great top lane pick.
Oh, last second swap.
That is sick.
Who does Never mind.
I mean, this is classic Sword Art as far as this pick goes. It's one that he's, you know, very comfortable playing with, so I'm really surprised that he's going to go for it today, but I'm also really excited to see him play this again.
What I really like about the Thresh pick, I mean, obviously it works well with Ashe. Again, low mobility, you have the Dark Passage, you're able to help her out, but more importantly, it should keep Hilly locked down in the lane. Not because it's going to push against him, but because it can really threaten against Veritas. You know, if that Jhin is locked up, it's much more dangerous for him to be in the lane by himself, which means that he should need a babysitter to hang out with him.
I love that you bring that point up, because if you make sure that Bard has to stay in the lane, you already mitigate some of that pressure that Jhin can utilize to just be by himself, to be Mia, because you need Bard to be there to babysit him. And the Thresh also offers such an incredible amount of CC that is just so obnoxious to deal with. And more importantly, against the likes of Rek'Sai, Flay will immediately cancel the burrow from Rek'Sai, the tunnels, which means that her ganking opportunities and any time that she tries to engage, if Thresh is there, it will be completely thwarted.
And a quite logical ending to the pick and ban phase for the Unicorns of Love with those three top lane bans and the Echo picked away. They are going to go to Gnar for Visit Chachi, which has been traditionally and historically in the ELCS a very good Gnar as well, but we're going to have to see what they can do. Curveballs upon curveballs, proving that we know nothing.
Should be noted, though, that Maple has played a unique champion for every single game.
Well, we'll see what the casters think of this, because, well, we were caught off guard a little bit. So, guys, what do you think?
We don't know what to think. Shox, I think that's the impression that I got from speaking to you, gentlemen, during the pick ban. This is very interesting. Flashful is picking some interesting bans, taking the entire top lane pool offline, and then seemingly getting every powerhouse meta pick available.
Yeah, I don't know how you get Ryze, Olaf, Ashe all on the same team. Nothing was taken away. The Rek'Sai is the really confusing thing for me. Why would Move pick that so early on in the draft? It's not contested. It just means they wanted to hide even more, because otherwise there's no reason.
Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head, Sifa. It's just mostly about the fact that the first pick came in, they were fishing for something. It was probably the Ryze. That was their first pick. But then because the second draft, or the first draft on the side of the red side, included a Rek'Sai that certainly wasn't going to be competed for in any way, they were in no way punished for the fact that they basically sacked their bans to get Ryze. Usually it's like, okay, we really want Ryze, and then you're giving up something like the Olaf and another power pick. They get three of the biggest power picks on this patch, champions that have been frequently banned, and that's just a really big price to pay for Unicorns of Love.
Of course, the Unicorns have found success. Cassio into Ryze in the past. Exile has proven to be a pretty big monster in that match, but the question is, can he do it against Maple the same way that he did against Talkers and INTZ? Very, you know, the potential for Snowball here is real. So frequently we've seen control mages going back and forth, very passive, very stalled out mid lanes, but both of these mid laners have the potential to kill each other at any moment.
And really intriguing to see the return of the Thresh as well. Sword Art Special obviously does provide that pick power. Ryze Root, the Ashe Arrow, Thresh can combo with all those things. So there's a lot of pick CC here from Flash. So it's just interesting to see that Thresh was the option with a lot of other supports available.
Yeah, UOL also has a lot of pick CC themselves with the Bard, with the long range from the Jhin and able to pick off. So I'm willing to see, or I want to see, sorry, I'll be willing to watch it too. I want to see who they're going to pick off, and if who gets out of position here and who is not actually staying with their team, because that's going to be very important in this matchup.
And then I think Move has to vindicate the ultra comfort pick. There's nothing else to say about Rek'Sai on patch 6.21 other than just comfort for Move in particular. Sure, it's well-trodden territory talking about the synergy between Rek'Sai and Jhin, just because Rek'Sai, Preyseeker hits, Jhin can hit the Deadly Flower. It's very easy setup and initiation CC. But on this patch, Rek'Sai has been deprioritized to an insane degree. So Rek'Sai still has creative pathing, a bit like the Shaker that was hovered for so long can come over walls.
Stop playing, we need to see Move
go crazy in the early game.
You're playing with my heart.
Playing with your emotions.
We got to see the summoner spell change, and it just baited me even further. But Flash Wolves do pick the Thresh. They do mix it up a little bit in the support department, but Unicorns Love. Of course, the question remains for Move in the jungle. It is that comfort pick. As Papa Smithy said, it has creative potential, but it's just not the powerhouse that most junglers are.
Yeah, it's comfort as well. Just Move loves that champion, and he loves the style where he's going for vision more than anything else. And Rek'Sai gives you free vision with the Tremor Sense just roaming around the jungle. And last time, Karsa ended up punishing Move for being in his jungle, and Move got caught out, and that was the very first blood that we saw when he had to go underneath turret as Olaf. So Move, with the Tremor Sense, it won't happen again in that same way, because you'll be able to see Karsa coming.
Absolutely. A little bit more utility there. Has the knockup as well. Good tools to set up the team. The Prey Seeker into the potential root from the Deadly Flourish on Jhin. So a lot more chain CC opportunities. Kind of the wombo combo built up here, but honestly have to respect the Flash Wolf's composition. So much raw power between the Ashe, the Ryze, and the Olaf.
Exciting to see Ryze on the Rift. You know, once again, Ryze has been reworked and deemed first ban, first pick worthy.
Every
the version's
time.
So flexible. I really like how the Ryze vs. Cassiopeia matchup in particular has evolved. This is always heavily to the side of Cassiopeia, a hard counter for most of the iterations of Ryze. But because of the flexibility, now you can choose, do I want that longer root duration? Do I want to have the shield on command, which obviously is very helpful when you go for trades? You'll still lose trades to Cassiopeia. That's not mince words. But it goes from a 90-10 matchup to a 70-30, and that's already pretty good because otherwise you get the flexibility of having Ryze and now his global presence on the map.
Yeah, and Ryze, even on top of that, now has earlier access to wave clear. He has the option or even the possibility to shove in a Cassiopeia, whereas before it wasn't that way at all. He had to actually kind of just take Cassiopeia's attacks over and over again for the laning phase and get shoved in. Now he can fight back.
The power of Spell Flux allowing for that early wave clear should make the lane phase a lot more comfortable. Sword Art consistently going for these aggressive trades, but Double Red seems to be on a different page, not going for the auto attacks.
Probably to be not to be expected that it is, again, a duo lane building synergy.
Of course, we've heard that Double Red has been a part of the team for a while, a substitute on the roster, but as Yip said, not as much chances to play on the big stage. But Double Red having solid performances thus far. Have to see if we can keep it up in game two. Flash Wolves have to be feeling pretty comfortable coming into this, up a game already. We ran into them on our break, and they were all laughing. I wish I spoke any Chinese so I could have, you know, learned anything from that encounter, but definitely having a good time.
Yeah, after a troubling series in the last one, sure, they went through 2-0, but of course there were the pauses, there were the gaps in momentum. It's good to see them still in high scores. They should be one game up against a team that is in their first final of all time. Flash Wolves, you look at them, they've been in so many finals, mostly domestic, but still have made their mark on international competition. Unicorns of Love with it all to prove.
That's the first time that Unicorns of Love are facing a team that isn't a wild card North American or European team. They're actually playing outside of their comfort zone here, and this is a style that they may not be used to. Flash Wolves, we talk about how they get to scrim Chinese teams as well as teams from the LCK in Korea. So this is kind of that blend where, you know, it might be a little bit slower, but they also take advantage of your misplacements, and it's just very quick once it hits that mid game, and then it slows down again, and they play a really, really calculated late game. It's kind of an awkward thing to play against, but if you haven't played against it before, it could be an issue.
Move. Nope. Walking forward, looking potentially for the double knockup. Does hit Sword Art. Sword Art left out and alone. Hillisang comes over the wall. Veritas is here as well. Chain CC and first blood drops for Unicorns of Love.
Best step towards vindicating the draft on the Rek'Sai. And this is the sort of thing that Rek'Sai is uniquely strong at. Has that Tremor Sense, can come over walls. Really nice play there. And crucially, move doesn't even have to flash. So he can still go for those much more powerful mid lane ganks when you have the flexibility to either flash first or tunnel first and have extra mobility to reposition.
Another great thing about this Rek'Sai is he gets to hand off the blue buff early to a tier Cassiopeia that just backed and picked it up. So it's a great timing here for Exile.
Really solid play coming in from the Unicorns of Love in the early game, getting all of these small advantages on top of the first blood as well, approaching a 1K gold advantage. But while things in the bot lane seem to be going very well, 32 to 23 as Ashe will recoup most of the differential there. Top lane remains even, mid lane as well, very even thus far. Both parties seeming content to stack up that tier, although posturing quite aggressively.
I start to see some of those trades that have developed.
Exile pushing forward, throwing down, gets the poison, looking
one more
for resets. Karsa coming in, not going
to
connect on the axe, looking for the
Karsa
reset.
Needs to be careful too.
Nice movement coming in from Exile.
That was awesome. So Exile actually played to the side of the Rek'Sai, and Flash Wolves, they respected that. They were like, all right, you know what, you're playing like your jungler's over here, and then they stopped immediately. They didn't actually continue to chase. Maple didn't use any summoner spells at all. Now he's just trying to push out and make sure that he can get at least a good back here, and Exile can't freeze. But it's actually not going to be enough. That's actually going to be frozen towards Exile, if I see that correctly.
Has to give up the Ghost, but the cooldown, of course, relatively low on this patch. And, you know, pretty comfortable just continuing to push out the mid lane here as well. Ryze under pressure in the early game. And, you know, level 6 for Ryze, not going to offer the boon of combat stats, but the Petrifying Gaze all powerful in the hands of Exile.
I think most of the time when we see those early blue buff transfers, we can't see an appreciable advantage that was got from having the early blue. Maybe some wave clears kept up. But the fact that Exile effectively 1v2'd I mean, the reason why Castle was drawn was not actually to get a successful kill, that would have been lovely, but the real reason was to allow Ryze to push out just to get a recall in. Instead, Exile outduels, controls the lane exactly as he wishes to, and gets maximum value from the blue buff.
Yep, ends up pushing it out really quickly afterwards and denies a little bit of CS there, so that's why he has about 6 CS as an advantage. Gets a nice back off, but also in the top lane, both TPs were just used here. Vizitachi with a little bit of a level advantage over MFD, but it won't last for too much longer.
They see the ward die on the bottom side, and they're waiting in the brush, hoping Sword Art will get aggressive as he did in the early levels, but Flash Wolf's tempering the aggression here.
Time.
In goes the portal, maybe looking for the setup. Double Red is caught out, he's all alone. Ooh, nice setup, but the knockup comes through. Sword Art's in trouble, move is knocked back under the tower. He's in trouble. Ooh. Blood coming in for Karsa, Hillisang, and Baratos. Now on the back foot, can they fight this out? It does not look like it. Karsa happy to just walk up to the axe, pick it up, look for the resets. Hillisang not going to drop. The auto goes in, but it's not enough.
Big mistake from Karsa. Throwing the axe short means they don't pick up the kill. They were smelling, but they thought there could be a triple kill there shared among the three members, but it's only the one.
And that was also Double Red flashing forward, not getting anything for it there, and Hillisang getting away. I mean, Hillisang, let's talk about it. That guy has actually been playing fantastically all week.
Veritas turning it around.
The curtain call. Just barely out of range.
Delaying the backs a little bit, and now they have to shove out. Hillisang even comes up to help him clear the wave faster. Look at this, they end up interrupting their recalls, and they're bringing Olaf down here once more. Karsa is in the area, he has Ghost, he has Ultimate.
Pink Ward.
This might be them dead, but nope.
Gonna back off to Settles to take the Pink Ward advantage, clearing out the little bit of vision on the bottom side, but the spot lane already explosive.
Yeah, but they saw him there, boom. Rek'Sai towards the top side, blue buff may go over to him.
Ryze needs that in this match. It may have the tier for mana, but of course can't afford to get this. Move only level 5 to Karsa's level 6. Should get the level 6 here, however. You can see the purple experience bar in the bottom corner ticking up. Exile gonna move over, grab another blue buff, continue to apply so much pressure in the mid lane, almost a 20 CS advantage in his
favor. Such high uptime on the blue buff as well. Got the first donation, now getting a second donation from the other side. Really difficult for Ryze, even as we said, a better matchup, but hard to hold up to this Cassiopeia.
It's also going to be even worse because the way that Rek'Sai ends up doing the jungle is you delay before you do your blue. So these are actually staggered blue buffs. As soon as this one wears off, Move's blue buff is actually going to be back up, and there'll be another one going over to Exile. So it'll be three pretty much in a row without any winning downtime there.
Exile continues to posture forward. Maple doing his best to clear out these waves safely and looks relatively comfortable in the lane, though, despite all of the small advantages going in favor of Exile. You did see the ghost burn from Karsa. A whole lot gained in that exchange, but surprisingly, Move keeping up with the Olaf here despite the insane clear speed that Olaf brings to the table, and Rek'Sai not even going for the early Tiamat.
And worth knowing that Move has spent a lot of Karsa spent a lot of time around lanes, you know, hasn't been focused on power farming like we might have seen another jungle like Crash, for example, often do stylistically, so just hasn't put himself in the position. Been focusing more on creating and relieving pressure, mostly around the bot lane.
Exile now getting cheeky, sees the red buff is respawning. Move behind Karsa. Ragnarok is available. He's just going to try to make this one out. That's
a lot of damage.
Exile moves forward. He wants to keep this ball rolling, and Maple is slowed down the stair.
Oh.
He has to flash to safety. Unicorns of Love, big moves on the bottom side.
Really nice team play as well. Everyone knew their role. They even forced the extra flash out because the Jhin had pushed up. Really nice team play from the Unicorns of Love.
Exactly. This is a team play all across the board because that's going to be another red buff coming around. That's going to be division denial in the jungle, and Move, this Rek'Sai is actually paying off so well. All of his lanes have CS advantages because he's going in, he's warding up, he's making sure that his lanes are safe, and then he's actually applying pressure. And every time Karsa shows himself, you have to assume that your other side of the jungle is warded, you get spotted out the next time you're there, and then they keep going back and forth. So they are actually keeping so much in terms of tabs on Karsa.
And you just come back to the Rek'Sai fate, we question it, but what you can tell from this match is how easy Unicorns of Love return to playing with a Rek'Sai. They clearly have practiced extensively around this champion. Everyone did throughout the year, but maybe even recently, this is probably still a scrim special because they move as if it's a pre-planned move. The pressure move is Veritas.
Veritas trying to get the setup. Nice. Locks up
really
two.
Nice.
Going to back out. Exhaust used in the end. Rek'Sai is there, but he's low from fighting the dragon. Hillisang caught out. Will he get into the portal? Can't make it out. Reckless swing. Going to keep Karsa open on the kill. Unicorns of Love barely making out with the dragon.
Yep, ended up trying to kite that way. Veritas and Hillisang were trying to get out and trying to head towards where they had their jungler, but Move was doing the Drake and really just wanted to finish it.
Oh, Exile caught out. Maple potentially looking for a little bit more. Maple now running for his life. Knows he can't afford the 1v1. Now Exile in complete control of the mid lane, but Flash Wolves have control of the bottom side. MMD messes up the phase dive, has to flash over the wall. Chachi's still with the flash available. Is he going to push for more? Echo has the ult, is going to snap back. Vision in the bush means he's not going to dodge any of those auto attacks. Chachi grabbing the solo kill. Yeah,
really nice stuff from Chachi. No Trinity Force yet, so not at the point where MMD can really fight against the Gnar. Wails away, takes him down. Unicorns of Love still keep their noses in front.
And this is a big issue for the Flash Wolves moving forward because they have two losing lanes in their solo lanes. Right here, Move looking to punish this. He knows there's no flash on Maple. Move has his own flash, and there we see it.
Knockup comes in, not facing the right way, but it doesn't matter. Exile pushing in for more. Flash forward, gets one Twin Fang, two. That's going to be the kill, and Unicorn's Love now on the mid lane tower.
Really nice roaming. Hillisang is unlocked, even though Jhin was zoned off the turret. They want first brick as well on Unicorns of Love, piling on the advantages.
The Cassio play coming in from Exile is absolutely unstoppable.
Oh, and they wanted to give him first turret blood. Let's see if it goes down. They have to split it. Have to stick around. Has to have Hillisang stay there.
Hillisang likes the gold, man. We've learned. Likes the big impact.
He's really just helping, you know?
I'm here to back you up just in case, man. I'm not here for the 300 gold, I swear.
And no one's getting punished across the map on the side of Unicorns. You saw on your screen Veritas able to get the last hits, even though he was zoned before. Actually ahead in CS against opponent Double Red. So despite playing around bot side, Karsa and other members, things still going relatively well for the Unicorns AD carry.
Yeah, and even across the board, you go to the top lane, Vizichachi, he got the TP out of MMD to return to the lane after the solo kill. Vizichachi has his own to possibly make a play in the future here.
Chachi now pressuring in on the top side. Echo will make it back, but not before a little bit of damage goes onto the tower. Almost a 4K gold lead in favor of the Unicorns. Echo doing his best to clear out what he can, but we were skeptical of the draft coming in from the Unicorns. Looked like a lot more comfort than raw power, but comfort appears to be paying off here.
It just makes you think of future games. Like, you come into game three, let's assume Unicorns, they carry it through, they pick up the win. Do you ban Rek'Sai? It sounds like a weird thing to do. We've seen weirder, but it sounds like a weird thing to do. But it's just the cleanness, or the clean approach they had invading the red, where everyone knew their role, they were all practiced, they all came up. It's one of those things that makes you think that if that playbook, that single playbook is so strong, why not just force them to abandon it?
Yeah, it's also possible that they pick it for themselves. Karso was a good Rek'Sai player very recently, right? I'm pretty sure he hasn't fallen out of practice. Rek'Sai's kind of like riding a bike. It's really easy.
It's just one of those things.
Once you played it once.
You think back to Worlds, you know, we got to semifinals, everyone's like, I don't know anything about Ashe. I don't think Ashe's in the meta. And suddenly, teams are first picking Ashe away from each other in SKT Rocks. It's crazy to think the Rek'Sai gets there, but we have these preconceived notions about what the meta champions do, what other ones don't do.
Oh, MMD in trouble, may get the chance to snap back here. But Chachi continuing to throw down so much pressure, alt traded for alt.
Yeah, and the fact that there's priority from Exile, you see he roams away from the mid lane. This will give him priority on top side, possibly to kill MMD, or just get the blue buff, get another buff. They've taken every single blue buff away, except for that first one.
They actually took both buffs from the last respawn. The red buff went over as well, and now it's gonna be the fourth blue buff, I believe, that Cassiopeia has been riding. This is when Castle Maple really starts to tilt. It's when you don't get any of the first three blues.
Yeah, you're like, he has a tier, I have a tier, and the difference? Well, let's see right now. 452 to 296. So Maple pretty far behind, 150. He got Definitely. His a little bit later, too.
And of course, on top of the blue buff, MMD not having TP in that exchange means that much more damage has gone into the tower. And it's just a matter of time before it falls over. Not going to take a whole lot, especially as Chachi continues to bully out here on the top side.
And I like that Exile actually puts the extra gold into picking up a QSS just to ensure the trades will continue to go in the advantage of the Cassiopeia.
Yeah, a lot of the times the Cassiopeia players will take cleanse, but cleanse, you only get to cleanse off 1 2-second root from the rise. So it's really all about, hey, you know what, I want to have that. And also the Ash Arrow is very important. You want to take the cleanse for that, but he really wants Ghost for the solo kill.
And the amusing thing is that because we don't see the QSS on Cassio very much, outside of maybe a Malzahar matchup, the big thing you can say is that, of course, Cassiopeia doesn't have to itemize for boots. So theoretically, even the late game has an extra item slot where you can waste it, I say in inverted commas, on something like QSS instead of ability power. So actually has more freedom than traditional mages in picking up the QSS.
Should be pretty comfortable. Even if it has to swap it out for the damage item in the late game, shouldn't hurt. Maybe you'll go full Mercurial Scimitar for the extra lifesteal.
Eventually.
Bit of attack damage there too. Movement speed boost.
That's my favorite late game tank build, is when they're like, all right, well, we need the QSS, and I have an extra 5,000 gold. We might as well turn it into something. Of course, Karsa doing what he can to clear out the vision in the jungle. That pink ward has been active for at least 5 minutes now, so Should be pretty happy to clear that one out, but Move and Hillisang, while they see him on the top side, are now free to move in on the bottom side. Unicorns Love completely in control of the game, setting the pace thus far, and no surprise to see a 4.5K gold lead, making it easy. Karsa stepping forward. Miasma goes down. Don't think we're going to see any follow-up here, but Hillisang is ready.
Unicorns Love continuing to pile on pressure. The next Drake spawns in 20 seconds, so for now that seems to be pretty academic for the side of Unicorns.
And
that's another Cloud Drake as well for UOL. They currently have one after the one that was picked up very early on.
While we're focused on mid lane and Exile is playing so well and it's this exciting matchup, every time we look top, well, looking mid now, just in case there's a solo kill. But every time we look top, you can see Gnar essentially just face tanking Echo's damage and just winning trades in mini form. This is devastating. Oh, set up here though.
Well, off on the bot side.
They're looking for more. Move is stepping forward. Don't know if they can afford the dive.
Ooh.
Oh, Hillisang caught out. Maybe looking for a little bit more. Exhaust does go down. Move can look for the knockup. Karsa, though, just going to use the Ragnarok to step away. TP from Gnar is mega. Has the potential to come in. Echo's here as well. Hillisang's going to make it out. Karsa over the wall, but he's guaranteed to get stunned. You don't follow a Bard. Curtain call. One shot Exile's going here. In. Two. Dodged out by MMD. Maple on the backside. Chachi now in trouble with Baratos. Grabs a kill. Exile popping off. Looking to take down Double Red, but the fancy footwork. Not enough. Double kill for Baratos.
Only one goes down. Amazingly, it wasn't Hillisang. It was actually Visit Chachi going for the big engage and taking focus fire. But massive rotation for Unicorns of Love. It's going to be another turret for them as well. Nothing Maple can do. Unicorns of Love, the power plays with this comp against the dream team that Flash Wars have put together. It's working out.
Well, maybe a dream team, but the fact that they had counters for both the Echo and the Ryze, the Cassiopeia and the Gnar, they have lanes that you can leave alone. You keep sending your jungler into the jungle to deal with Karsa. Karsa has to help these lanes if they want to win, and the fact that he isn't able to and he has to keep going bottom or elsewhere, that means that those one-on-ones, they just keep perpetually losing. They get priority to go the other lanes faster. You get to get out of vision earlier and get to TP and be proactive.
3-0-2 for both of the carries, Exile and Veritas, having a fantastic fight there. Unicorns of Love, honestly looking unstoppable in these last few skirmishes, making the aggressive calls, but as we sort out the positives as quickly as possible, we will take a chance to look at some of the replays from earlier in this game, specifically
this
last fight.
You can see just the priority that is here. You see Ryze and Cassiopeia leave at about the same time, which normally wouldn't be able to do that. Karsa just keeps chasing him down. It's a really good teleport here. Sword Art does the right move of actually throwing his hook backwards to protect Double Red, but the fact they don't even get Hillisang. And here, Exile arrives even faster than Maple. Maple has the rank 2 ultimate, doesn't end up using it at all to try and get in even faster, and that gives Exile the inside track.
Yeah, Maple wasted a lot of time trying to kill the Gnar. Eventually got it, but of course couldn't help his team in any other way. Back to live, and Flash Wars have no time to stand back and lick their wounds. We saw Flash Wars last game, if you recall, having that time to wait. We didn't see the initiations coming in from Unicorns of Love. And Flash Wars, they made the decisive moves. But this gold lead, it's ballooning out of control early. Remember, we're not even 20 minutes. Rift Herald's still on the map. And it's over a 7,000 gold lead.
Terrifying to play against. Move making his way in to clear out some vision. Sword Art and Karsa not going to make it so easy.
Ooh.
But the arrow going wide is not at all what Flash Wolves need. And no longer is there the victor. No longer is there this safe wave clear. So Flash Wolves, they have a great wave clear with the Ryze, but he has to approach the wave. And I don't know if he's going to have that luxury.
I mean, it's not just that he has to approach the wave. It's a rotation of spells. He has to wait an extra few seconds. And you might think, okay, 3 seconds, 2 seconds, whatever it is, it's not a big deal. But when you're victor, you can walk over to a wave, mouse over it, wave clear, and leave. You don't have to stick around for the extra rotation. So you're predictable as Ryze. And there's a lot of CC, especially when Move, like someone like Move has Flash, to catch out that Ryze.
Exile going in, doesn't even care. Maple set to fall. Twin Fang, double damage proc to close it out.
Got his Flash on top of it as well there. So Maple, it's going to look even worse for him moving forward. The Cassiopeia, the combo, ulti into Miasma. They can't flash away right there. They have to take all that damage, and they're poisoned.
And you never see people dictate to dictate to Maple like Exile is doing in this game. This guy is embracing the limelight that comes in playing his first international tournament and doing it just amazingly.
His first finals as well, right? We're talking about a raw rookie here, guy who's only been playing in the professional scene for one split. It's absolutely incredible because Maple, he's been battle tested. We've seen him at Worlds multiple times, 3 years. that's crazy, that fact that every time Maple comes in, we're like, this Maple Karsta duo, really damn good. Somebody has to deal with it because they dominate mid lane. Exile, he's able to deal with this right now.
And the amount of experience he has at such a young age is absolutely insane. But even all that experience doesn't matter in the face of this Cassio. Exile clearly comfortable in piloting it. And we're seeing, yeah, it's that 70-30, but that 70 is a hefty number to overcome.
Yeah, for some people it's experience, but the one thing you learn from here is temperament. There's a lot of potential excuses you could give Exile underperformed at this tournament. Oh, he's a rookie. Oh, you know, it's his first time traveling for an international event. None of those have come to pass. He has been on point for the majority of the games, and he continues to do that even under the lights of the final.
And I think that's a very interesting thing to talk about as well, because we talk about, oh, those would be excuses if he wasn't performing well, but now I think because he's performing well, we say despite those things, he is performing well, despite being a rookie, despite this being his first time in a finals, despite the fact that he's going up against somebody of the caliber of Maple, he is still thriving.
Of course, now getting back into game. But the game very heavily in favor of UOL after a pretty crushing defeat. Looks like they are not feeling shattered whatsoever.
And I'm really excited to see. Let's assume Unicorns are love stick to the line. I'm really excited to see the draft in game three, because Flash Wolves basically gave up their bans to reach for priority picks, and Unicorns love like, okay, counterpicking in lanes, going with the Rek'Sai that people thought was completely out of the way, and gonna dominate. And if they can, especially if they continue in this fashion, you know, dominating the Flash Wolves, suddenly we're gonna have to see a bit more attention paid to the pick of man from Flash Wolves in game three.
I would even say the Gnar is something that you don't expect to come out. You left Jace on the board, you take Echo and you ban three other champions. So you have to kind of expect that that's the one coming out, or that the Jace is, but the Gnar is something that may have not have been accounted for here, because it is quite good into Echo.
What I will say is that both these teams have done their homework. One of the notes I had pre-series was that, oh, both these teams banned Jace on blue and red side. Just like SKT in the past would ban Nidalee on blue and red side, the first thing you think is, okay, these teams don't play that. And while Bengi answered that criticism, if we continue to see, let's say we see five games in this series, if we continue to see Jace left open, someone will pick it eventually, because the power level is super high on that champion. MMD, he had been playing it in solo queue during Worlds, so clearly these guys have played the Jace. They don't favor Jace comps, but when the power level's that high, someone has to grab it.
I think that's the big thing, is these teams don't favor Jace-type compositions. They favor a tank in the top lane. They favor somebody very bruisey. It's not really Visichachi's style as a playmaker, somebody who loves things like the Shen. We even saw him on Gangplank, which was kind of a far cry from the style that he usually likes to play. And MMD, it's the same story. And right now, people are considering Jace as somebody who doesn't do quite well into tanks. He'll beat them in the first few levels, but then eventually, just his TPs are not as effective as every other champion that you would play in the top lane.
Shout out to the audience, cheering for the pause. Much appreciated.
That's better than ward kills.
Take it.
Don't get them started.
Of course, waiting to get back into game, but you saw relatively calm thus far, but now at the 22-minute mark, Flash Wolves have to be painfully aware of the potential for a Baron attempt here. Exile is the Cassio, the insane amount of sustained damage that can come out.
And the items are just, you know, overflowing on the side of Exile and the rest of the Unicorns of Love. You know, he went for the early QSS, he's now just finished Archangels. Then you look on the side of Flash Wolves, MMD's a long time away from being relevant. We've already seen six-item Echo struggle to be relevant in teamfights. Six items looking a long, long way away when you just have Boots and the Trinity Force, just a pure damage threat. And speaking of damage, Unicorns have an unbelievable amount of Baron damage.
Yeah, they're going to do it with just two members here, movable tank. And then as soon as it gets to about half HP, they'll pull in the Jhin, and then that's kind of the jig is up.
Olaf is in the area.
Olaf's running straight towards it.
Have to trade tank here. Can he steal it away? Oh, he gets it in the end. Karsta now potentially the one in trouble. Hillisang has already used the ultimate. They're going to back off, but Unicorns of Love get another early Baron.
Yeah, throws down the ultimate and almost gets himself in there. Karsta throwing down the ghost. And then another pause.
Round of applause. Round of applause. I agree. I agree. That Baron take was good.
Oh, yeah, it was actually quite good, quite clever. I don't know how long they've had to actually plan that one out. Something's brewing in their minds.
Yeah, the one thing you can say is that a shot caller gets a lot of time to consider what the next move is.
Yeah.
Of course, don't get to talk to each other, but the second it starts up again, you'd be like, all right, we're doing this. It's happening.
The luxury.
Of course, one of the big things about Cassio, when she's so far ahead of the clock, so often we see it being Mountain Drakes that allow her to do that so quickly, but when she's got this many items this early on...
Turns out solo kills are pretty good, too.
10k gold in the Cassio pocket, a 3k lead over the Ryze, so no surprise that she pretty much can take on anyone at this stage of the game.
And you just start to worry. I mean, I was speaking about items a bit before. You know, Veritas, he's got the standard. You know, he's got the Yoma's Ghostwave. He actually went for the rapid fire second. Then you look over on MMD, he's got Ninja Tarbi. There's no other armor item on anyone else on the squad, so we know about the early power spikes that someone like Jin can put out. May not be the Duskblade with the Yomas, but still, flat armor penetration against almost no answer on the side of Flashwolves. There's no Braum, they went for the Thresh. I don't know who Thresh is hooking, because whoever he's hooking is probably turning around and killing people on the side of Flashwolves.
Not at all where they want to be. Of course, you have the Black Cleaver as well, so even when that armor starts to come in, because Gnar is so far ahead, it's going to be worth so much less. Have to know that the team fights clearly favor in the Unicorns of Love, the split push in favor of the Unicorns of Love. Everything is stacked in their favor, but the question now remains, can they close out with confidence? We did see a lot of back and forth in the previous game, very extended, despite the Flash Wolves' leads coming in there.
But there was touching distance, right? Unicorns were winning for parts of the first game, but there was touching distance to the extent where Flash Wolves were strong enough as a five-man group to put pinks, to actually have defensive vision around Baron. They were nowhere near that strength here, so on spawn or just a minute after Baron, and they've actually been able to take that big objective that eluded them through the course of game one.
22 and a half minutes, and you already have Baron, and it was a two-man Baron to boot. That's actually insane. That's how far ahead they are right now, is two levels up for Exile, close to that level 16, hitting 15, and Vizichachi, same thing for him in that top lane. And these are just some great picks here that they've been able to pull out and get as counters. And that first pick Ryze, I don't know if we'll see it again unless you can get rid of Cassiopeia. It's just so strong as a counter.
So, I mean, let's take this opportunity as we do have hopefully a brief break here, but let's talk a little bit about draft coming into this, because I feel like so often the prevailing wisdom for like a baseline level for best of strategies, if it's not broke, don't fix it. You can just come in with the same game plan. If it worked in game one, rinse and repeat here, but Flash Wolves completely mix it up. We're seeing comfort picks now prevail. Do you think we're going to continue to see the trend of banning out top lane? What really has to change here?
I mean, the bans in this game are peculiar at minimum, bizarre at most. It's one of the things where I'd love to talk to Stake and be like, all right, game two of this series, you know, maybe in a couple months he'll be ready to speak about it. You know, what was the thought process here? Because he's basically banning out Poppy counters, then banning Poppy on Blue's side, and you're just like, okay, I guess you really want something to get the Ryze. You can sort of follow that far, but there's so many other things they could have done, more balanced draft that would have helped them. Same thing I felt about the Velcos that ended up being, I guess, not enough of an advantage for Unicorns of Love to take in game one. So I feel like the drafting's been bizarre, and I'm waiting for a couple more games, and especially how they respond to a loss, to see how big an adjustment Flash Wolves will make.
Exactly, because when you're in that situation, you don't have to ban the Poppy. You leave Poppy and Ryze up. Maybe UOL decide to ban one of them themselves, and then you get the other. Or you test UOL, see if they're smart enough to actually deviate from whatever plan they had, and if they ban neither of them, then you pick whichever one you think is stronger.
And while it's easy to see how Unicorns of Love can pull out a win here, a massive lead backing them up, I want to ask, what can Flash Wolves do? What options are left to this lineup? Although we're going to have to hold that thought. Little action does come in, and Move is going to get stunned up, although we'll buffer out.
I mean, they can wait, right? They can scale. There is still a world where they can be competitive. It's just with the items they land, they really can't do anything. They're the ones being dictated to. It's not just the Baron, it's also the gold, it's the advantages. If they can find some gaps in the vision, sure, try and pile on, kill someone, force Unicorns of Love to back away, but that's the most you're gonna hope for.
Oh, three.
Realm comes in, delivering in, but the arrow misses. Chachi just gonna flash out, does have the frozen mouth, but they are gonna look for the pick here. Cassio's on the bottom side in the meantime, but Chachi is set to fall. Veritas throwing in a bit of poke. The remaining members, out comes the curtain call, denying any potential option to maneuver down to the bottom side. Cassio keeping the push going. Exile happy to have that tower.
Yeah, and he's going to continue to push. They're going to get two for this from Unicorn's Love side. I say if you trade yourself for that, that is definitely worth.
Veritas backing off, taking a decent amount of poke there. But as you said, trade very much in favor of Unicorn's Love.
I mean, Baron buff's still there, so this is actually a pretty relevant push, even though it's an AP character and Cassiopeia split pushing.
Has so much AP under her belt as well, so still does a decent amount to the tower. Half health down. Of course, we mentioned it before, it will regenerate, but one more strong push on the bottom side could break open the inhibitor line for the Unicorns of Love.
Oh. This time it's the teleport.
Can they take down Exile?
They're five-manning one person at a time. Exile. Flash Wolves.
Not going to flash out from the CC. Content to turn this one around. Olaf cannot be disabled, and they are going to cut down the Cassio before she does some decent damage. But
so this time, Unicorns of Love punished them with a Grom. So this one is certainly not the punishment that we saw in the first series.
I don't know, man.
Yeah. The first time, okay, took a lot of punishment. Second time, game plan works for Flash Wolves. This also disrupts the rhythm. There's going to be some hateful words, I'm sure, like, what are you guys doing on the rest of the map? Understandable question coming through from Exile. Maybe not the hate and the words, regardless. It's going to be some Inquisition. And it's two people that have died after a period of basically smothering dominance. So Flash Wolves hoping that can disrupt the momentum they were on.
Double Red caught out. Arrow goes in. He's going to go down. Tempered Fate. His Ajachi's safe now, not that he wasn't already, but Hillisang just wanting to contribute to the team.
Yep, gets the flash to boot as well, and now they're just going to continue to push up this mid lane here. Baron buff still on them for just a little bit longer. It'll be about one or two more waves.
Ajachi moving in, does get hooked up, but Meganar is available. No flash for him, however. Did burn it in the previous exchange. They're moving in to get the dive down. Baron buff still up and available on Veritas.
Crucially, they pushed out the bot lane, so they can't go and get down to the chunked bottom lane turret and try to take that down. So just brute force for Unicorns of Love in mid.
No Meganar up and available. Karsa does have the Ragnarok as well. Sword Art gets stuck under the wall here, but Echo looking for the side flank. He does have a good setup. That's going to be stunned onto Hillisang as well as move. Hilly gets popped, but Exile is here. He is up. He has the Petrifying Gaze available. Flash Wolves forced to back off.
No summoners from Exile. He did use them despite being almost certain to die, not even pick up a return kill. So double pink wards actually put down off any flanking vision. So cost here not completely insignificant for Unicorns of Love.
Yeah, it looks like you are all going to go straight for the Ocean Drake. Right after that, try to get a little bit of that back. Spent a lot of time on these turrets, and they're getting them rather low, but you have to kill them.
The one thing that hasn't gone the way of Unicorns of Love has been the Drake RNG. If this had been a couple of mountains,
true.
An Infernal on a mountain, that would have really cemented what has been their control on the map. But it being just the ocean and the cloud, it's not quite the same influence on the map. We saw how fast they could take the Baron just in a duo without any mountain drakes and Infernals. They had some of those.
Oh,
would
yeah.
have been even faster when it respawned.
You would absolutely love some mountains around this time. Able to take those turrets. Those would have gone down.
Sure.
Already able to duo clear a Baron, maybe even solo clear if you pick up an extra couple of mountains, but starts to sound a lot like Achilles. We gotta stop with the Cloud Ocean commentary. All dragons are created equal. Papa Smith,
LCK
movement
cost
speed.
Is like that fire, man. What can I say?
Oh, EU too. EU, we're definitely not big fans of the Cloud Drake.
I mean, the Cloud Drake maybe allowed Exile to get in range, you know, and start his combo.
Think of what he could do out of combat.
And then get into combat.
Focusing back in as the tier 2 drops on the top side. Unicorns of Love setting up for a siege. A lot of tools to start the fight, but move.
He's
has
tanked.
To be careful. That's a solid setup. Chachi no Meganar available. Exile is stunned up. Whoa. That's a massive knockup. Sword Art is getting burned down. Exile dealing decent damage to nobody as he's not able to get in, but the Miasma is still ticking down. Move is cut down. Double Red trying to make it out. Maple is tanking those shots, but they have to choose. Are they going to die to Bow? One shot. Final kill coming in. Exile hungry for more. QSS is out. MFD stunned up. That's going to be the ace onto Flash Wolves. Unicorns of Love tearing down the Flash Wolves.
They finally got the kills. Looked like it would be an awkward exchange because no one could get to move, but they changed target, took down the frontliner. Everyone else falls down, and Unicorns of Love, couple of pushes away from ending the game.
Yeah, and they're going to be able to take down this turret. They have this minion wave pushing up, and it'll probably be the inhibitor on top of it. Just a lot of damage here, and I absolutely love the fact that Exile came from the side when you didn't expect him to come from that angle, and then immediately Maple had to abandon Double Red and let him take that
like,
last shot.
Listen, you can die, or he can die.
Or we can die.
Or everybody can die. That's the Exile way. 5-1-6.
And we've been kind of falling over ourselves to praise Exile during the course of this series, but let's also look at Move. A guy so maligned, he's often the punching bag when this team loses. Love the aggression, the mindset of understanding that bashing in there with the damage was going to chunk out the front line. Thresh dies to incidental damage. And even though Move gives up his life, it's the go button that you sometimes need, whether it's Malphite and Silver, or in this case, the flashing in from the Rek'Sai. It does the job. They clean up the kills, and Unicorns of Love on the knocking on the door of evening up the series.
Yeah, Move has been an instrumental part of this. The comfort pick for himself, keep in mind as well, this is Move in his first finals as well.
moving in to take down the Baron now. Should be easy for them to do it. Karsa, no massive mobility tools. Does have Smite up and available. Ragnarok, too. Karsa ready to zone them out. Exile. Vizichachi has the Mega Gnar looking for the setup.
Whoa.
Goes golden. That's a nice freeze frame, but Chachi now gets stunned up. This could be the potential to turn, but Baratos goes guardlike. In comes the curtain call. Double red gets popped. There is too much damage. Double kill for Chachi.
And immediately, URL going to go towards that top lane. The inhibitor's already down. They have a super minion. They might push for the win here.
It's only Ryze for wave here. Maybe a couple of axes from the Olaf. Death time is 30 seconds on the Ash. This might be the game.
I don't think it's going to be enough. QSS up and available for Exile too, so nothing is going to stop him from throwing down this damage. Maple doing his best to clear the waves. The super minions are here. Move looks for the knockup. Karsa simply too tanky. Exile hungry maybe for another kill, but Move gets stunned. Move not going to get dropped. Exile locked up. Chachi moving forward. Mega Gnar on the way. The tower is dropping. Flash Wolves are falling down. Flash Wolves are going to lose the second game. Unicorns of Love pull out the comfort picks and pull out a win.
Really great stuff from the Unicorns of Love, and they did it their way. This has always been the case with this org. They come out, they go for the pick and ban that we question, I think, rightfully so. It looked like there was so much power on the side of the Fast Wolves, but you do the double take, you consider the comfort that was over to someone like Move, who struggled to impress, and they got the counter picks in lanes, ran with it after great pathing from Move, and a comfortable victory for the Unicorns of Love.
And it just goes to show, sure, you can pick a lot of power picks, but there are counters to a lot of these champions, and the fact that the team composition doesn't exactly synergize completely well for Flash Wolves, UOL were able to outdraft them a little bit, get some good counters, play a lot of their comfort, and then they were able to take the win.
Remember, there were other options available here for the Flash Wolves. They did grab the Olaf in the second rotation. Could have been in Italy that Karsa piloted so well in the previous game. They had options. They went for power. They certainly got it, but it wasn't enough, and they wilted under the pressure in game two.
That's going to have to see if that remains a trend, how Flash Wolves can compose themselves moving forward. But you've heard enough from us. Let's send it back to the Xfinity analyst desk to break down that win for the Unicorns of Love.
Welcome back to the Xfinity analyst desk. Indeed, after that, the Unicorns of Love bringing it back 1-1, all squared up. And we got to talk about the picks and ban phase that we were caught a little bit off guard of some of the plans coming out of the Flash Wolves, which seemed like a good idea and gave them a lot of power picks in theory. How come some of these did not work out when it came to the actual game?
Well, the Rek'Sai and Bard combination is just so deadly in terms of ganks. That's how they got the first blood over the wall with the Jhin following up from very far away. And then you have Bard that can use a magical journey to really get on top of you. So it's very difficult for you to track this Rek'Sai. We're going to check it out right here. It's
perfect.
Such a great first blood. It's going to get comboed with the Root from Jhin immediately with the Magical Journey, and you really can't ask for a better execution on this first blood.
And that reflected pretty much a Move score, the fact that he was sitting close to 100% kill participation for almost the entire game, as well as opening up that opportunity for them to sneak the Baron by having that Rek'Sai tankiness alongside the burn from Cassiopeia.
Yeah, I mean, it's really good to see, because in the past games that we've seen from UOL, like, we can basically point at Move as being pretty much the weakest link on the squad. So he's got a lot of criticism from the community as well. So for him to step up in this game and to be the playmaker to set up that first blood and just continuously help net these kills for his squad, it's really promising for Unicorns of Love, not only just moving forward into this tournament, but going into the Spring's play.
I love that gank right there. That's my favorite gank of all time, especially for Rek'Sai. You come in over the Raptor wall and you go straight onto the mid lane and you make sure that you just punish him tremendously because he misses out on this wave, and it's going to be the bottleman that catches it, and that just puts Ryze even further behind. And he got to a point where he was getting soloed 1v1 by the Cassiopeia with a really nice purchase of the QSS, not only to help you in the 1v1 against Ryze, but to mitigate the arrow.
And it's always so obnoxious to play Ryze into the Cassiopeia, just because when you're trying to unload all of your damage, you have to do it through multiple spell rotations, which means instead of just dropping that one and then turning away from her to guard against the petrifying gaze, you're facing her the entire time, and it's so much more micro-intensive.
Yeah, and Exile continuing to step up to the plate and dealing huge amount of damages on Cassiopeia. And then we also have to think about the top lane, Ekko versus Gnar. They sacrificed 3 top lane bans to get possibly a good matchup. They didn't, and Gnar can completely walk away with that lane as well.
Mistakes were made, and yeah. I'm sure that they'll learn for the next game. I mean, once again, Jace goes completely unnoticed. These teams don't really seem to have a whole lot of priority on this, but it definitely, I think it will come out as the series progresses. But unfortunately, just MD just not holding a light towards Visichachi's candle.
Not on this one.
There's also the inherent problem of just throwing up multiple bans at top lane anyway. Like, it's fine to ban away the Jace and possibly sometimes the Kennen, but I feel like that pool is probably one of the widest in terms of the viable champions available, that even if you throw, like we just saw, three bans at it, there's still something that you get that you want.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, I just feel like MMD, as much praise as I just gave him in the last game, at the end of that last game, he kind of just completely reversed all that. But I think that it's just maybe just an off game for him, the matchup. I've never really seen him play the Echo too much, or too well, I guess. I've never seen him really, like, excel on that champion. So I think hopefully he can come back in and then maybe prove me wrong if it comes down to that. I doubt that we're going to see the same top lane focus in the bans when we come back in. Maybe something more around the jungle, perhaps, because I mean, the Rek'Sai was kind of out of left field. We weren't really expecting that one with the Nidalee still on the board. But so we might see some tighter pinch around that
I instead. Actually think that the Rek'Sai wasn't as big as a problem as the Bard. This Bard has just been stomping people left, right, and center. Just did a number on TSM, and once again, just did so much work in the sense of you have to defend against a Tempered Fate, and the stun is just so annoyingly good. We saw one time where he was barely able to escape the grasp of Karsa just because the axe just wasn't thrown long enough, just walking towards the,
walking in a straight
little
line,
health
by
pack.
The way.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, where, yeah, great walking by the
I'm sorry,
contender towards MVP, but yeah, like this
Whole
Bard,
is,
like, you don't ban GP, ban Bard. This guy's carrying.
Yeah, for sure, and it's also something that Heilasang has been able to play very well in the past in the European LCS, but we haven't seen coming out because of the relevance of the other picks, so it's definitely showing that even with the Tahm Kench off the board, he has a really, really strong power pick in that bottom lane as well, and this, of course, is the tug of war of the pick and ban phase in a best of five, or in the first game, they managed to win with the mid lane pick that's unconventional for the Flash Wolves, at least, and pull it out in another way. This time around, the Unicorns of Love know that they have given up all these power picks and they can still manage to win a game. So confidence-wise, that's definitely good going into game three.
It's a big mental game to play with them. Again, like you said, the fact that you get everything that you want and they beat you anyway, pretty much, again, playing standard. We haven't seen the weird pocket picks from Unicorns of Love, so I love that they've redefined themselves.
And I think a cool thing about these best of fives is that we always see it devolve out of the traditional meta and into the best of five specific meta, where you stop banning the picks that affect most teams and start banning specifically what is going on in the game, which is why I want to see what was currently banned in the top side. It just completely gone. Target the Bard, target other picks that you think are important, like the Cassiopeia, the Ryze, perhaps, if you don't want Exile to be playing that pick, as that might be the reason why they first picked it and struggled so much with it. And then eventually we can see a matchup that is more detailed towards each specific team.
Yeah, that was a really weird one. I don't know. And I also think that the ban is, like you said, the ban phase is going to be completely different, especially from the sides of the Flash Wolves, because I think the Bard does need to be taken off the board. Both of the games that they won in their best of three against TSM, it was Bard. Heilasang was very crucial in those victories, constantly landing the Cosmic Bindings. I mean, he had beautiful Tempered Fates to just disrupt Wild Turtle in the backline during the curtain call. So I think that that's something that they have to take off the board if they want to find success. And they can afford to let something through. Like, they banned the GP was their first ban out for the Flash Wolves. That's something that they could definitely let
Mistake
through.
Mistake number one.
Yeah, because, I mean, we expected, like, they're going to go for the Poppy, and then they banned the Poppy. So it was a really weird ban
but
phase.
But we're riled up. It was super exciting, and it's all squared out, and I think it might go all the way to five games. Let's hope so. At least we're going to give the teams some time to regroup and get back for game three on the Rift between the Unicorns of Love and the Flash Wolves right after this.
And now, League of Legends on the Totino Bucking Cow.